Maybe I can get my backpack in there.
Would you sit
in here? No, I can sit there. It's fine.
Thank you. going to be very brief. I know you're very excited. I want you to know, though, that you have helped make Grand Rapids Public Schools history. City High has been ranked among the top schools in America. It is because of you.
Tough days ahead of you. It seems like it was just yesterday since we arrived at City High. So do not do what is expected of you. Rather, accomplish what you expect from yourself. I've had the privilege of spending more than 4 years with several of you, and those sweet memories will not be forgotten. It is those memories that will one day make me smile when I'm feeling reminiscent. I will remember our first day at City High / Middle School when the seniors seemed to tower over us. I will recall our 10th grade English class when we had Miss P call us her passion flowers. I will remember all of us investing hours into a car project only to have it fail at the last minute. I will vividly remember our homecoming team last year, which gave the class of 2011 their victory. I will also recall my wonderful senior year, which gave me the opportunity to make new friends and get to know all of you better. We bonded over complaining about the heavy workload. Now, I do not know if it was the work that was too hard or if we all had bad cases of senioritis. Lastly, I will never forget how our class year grade is, since we had the opportunity to make other grades look bad during homecoming week, but we did not.
Class spirit.
superintendent. She is a part of the superintendent's council, and boy, she really helped me during the past 5 months, giving me your opinion, steering me in the right direction so that I could hear the voice from the student, and I appreciate that. So I would like to give you this certificate for all your hard work for helping me during the past 5 months.
It ends with us, and we know it, because class of 2012, yeah, love you all.
Thank you. 2001, Mike Rios graduated from City High, where he was voted most likely to fall asleep at his own wedding. He has since earned a degree in advertising, worked for some big ad agencies, taught English in Thailand, backpacked across Asia and South America, wrestled a bear, meditated with mountain monks, and survived a three-day-long bus ride where they played the entire Rocky Hexology. That's Rocky 1-6 all in a row. He's been living in Cambodia since 2008, where he co-founded 17 Triggers, a consulting company that uses creative brainstorming and visual thinking to help nonprofits and governments from around the world solve stagnant problems, from decreasing school dropouts to triggering people to buy their very first toilets. Mike flew here today from Cambodia to throw down some wisdom before flying to Zambia tomorrow morning. Please give a warm welcome to Mike.
Okay, I'm just kidding, all right. Anyway,
Chim is that you can do a Dong Chim to anyone. You can do a Dong Chim to Mr. Van Eyck. Or if you want it, you can Dong Chim Mr. Brandon. Or you can do what we call an El Duplo Dong Chim, and Dong Chim both your Spanish teachers at the same time.
Skipping those intro film classes,
But you'll find people who will push you back because they see you as just a young, naive kid. I think this is why the first internships or jobs can sometimes be frustrating. You're thirsty for more and no one wants to give you water. But what's important is that you don't get frustrated. Don't sit in your room bitter at the world. Don't complain. And that is the first don't to epiphany. Complaining solves nothing. The world is filled with lots of things that might frustrate you or push you down. But if you complain, nothing will ever change. Work within the system, stay positive, and you'll find others like Rachel who are doing the same. You're going to someday have a boss who you can't stand, who is slow, and doesn't even know how to use a computer. But don't complain. Better just to laugh at how cute he looks when you're complaining solves nothing. Bitterness solves nothing. And the sooner you can eliminate those from your mind and start cultivating patience and positive thinking, the fuller your life will be. Inside the classroom, my greatest lesson came from a professor named Anton. He was a young, charismatic professor who at the time was just a little bit older than I am now. His class was about identity, about how we perceive ourselves and who we are. He kicked off the first class by saying that if you came here to get an easy A, then this class is not for you. This will be the hardest class you ever will take in your life, but I promise you, if you stay, you'll also learn more here than you can ever imagine. Anton continued to tell us about the strange things people do to keep an identity. He asked us, what makes it cool for someone to sit in the back of class, legs out, arms crossed, listening to music? Is it the movies? Is it the advertisements? When someone sits like that, he said, they make a statement to the world that they don't care and that they'll never care. What doesn't make sense is that when these same people pay a lot of money to go to university, but they're not learning a single thing. Professor Anton had nailed it. His words were a much-needed dagger to my false identity. Who was I kidding? For years, I had projected an identity that said I was too smart for school, or that I didn't need it, but really I was just a young punk, a fake. I was a waste of time because I felt school was a waste of time, and I never gave university a chance. From that day on, I studied very differently. I sat in front of classes, and I actually read books. I cared about learning. But Don't Chim Epiphany 2 isn't about reading and sitting in the front row. It's about identity. You'll learn in your life that you can constantly reinvent who you are. You might be a young punk now, but you don't have to be. You might be shy now, but you don't have to be. You might not know who you are now, but you can create who you want to be. The secret is you have to surround yourself with good, positive people. Whether you go to university or you don't, the people you choose to be with will either help you grow, or they'll drag you down. The world is full of cocky young punks, complainers, drunk party guys, and superficial, materialistic girls. The world is also full of bright, curious, positive people who pull out the best in you, the parts you haven't discovered yet. For years, you've been labeled as one of those smart city kids, or that quiet girl, or the guy who falls asleep at the back of his class. But today, if you want to, you're free to start fresh and move on to a place where you have no labels. It was the end of my freshman year when one of my best friends, or two of my best friends, Anthony Stepner and Kaylee Kelly, who are also here today, decided to study abroad in Brazil, and they invited me to join them. Until that point, I only knew a few people who studied abroad, and I always admired them. Living abroad was something I never thought that I could do. The thought of leaving home for a few months scared me. I kept thinking, wouldn't I miss so many things here? But somehow Anthony convinced me, and I decided to study black and white photography in Brazil. The summer semester ended up being one of the most influential periods of my life. I'm certain if it weren't for that one trip to Brazil 10 years ago, I would have never backpacked across Asia, or volunteered in India, nor traveled throughout South America. I wouldn't be working around the world, and I wouldn't be standing in front of you here now. I can't recommend living abroad enough. You may be scared and you may think that you're going to miss out by living abroad for a semester, but really you miss out on so much more if you stay here and never try. You can live life forever scared of the barriers you set for yourself, or you can break them down. I promise you, once you break the first barrier, all the other barriers start falling with it. And for the parents out there who are making really, really uncomfortable right now, look at it this way. If your son or daughter lives abroad, they'll come back much more flexible, curious, creative, patient, thankful, open-minded, wise, and caring. You can ask my mom if she's here today. And when people in our generation hear about my travels, a lot of people ask me, oh, I wish I could go there. How'd you do it? I tell them it's easy. You just save money and you can go. And sadly, most people never do it. But the thing is, as an American, you actually can do it. Most people in the world will never be able to afford even a suitcase. They don't know what a passport is, and they'll never be able to leave their own village. You actually have a choice. It's kind of like, as an American, when you graduate from high school, you get this awesome free mountain bike. You get placed on a narrow path, and off the narrow path is a beautiful mountain in the distance. If you're like most people, you would look at the mountain from afar and say, oh, I wish I could go there. But you'd be too scared of riding up the narrow path that you know. So you keep riding up and down the same narrow path over and over again for years, until the narrow path gets deeper and deeper, and it's even harder to get out. But if you dare to explore, you'll find it's easy to create a new path until you reach the mountain. Sure, you'll find some bumps, or you might even get a flat tire, but you'll also see a waterfall, a river, and some other hidden secrets you never knew existed. You gotta get off your narrow path. Living abroad is one of the most rewarding things you can do in your young adult life, and you won't know until you try it. And for all your life, for all your life, people have always asked you, what do you want to do when you grow up? What are you going to do with your life? The problem with this question is when you try to answer it, you probably imagine yourself as a 30 or 40 year old. And you also start to think about that you'll do that job for the rest of your life. Now, some of you may do one job for the rest of your life, but the reality is for most of you, whatever you think you want to do now, it will change. If you would have told me that when I was a senior, that I'd be living in Cambodia today, I would have told you that you're crazy. Allow me to try to list all the jobs I've had or applied for since I graduated from City. Videographer, production assistant, Asian male model, assistant editor, junior copywriter, tourism photographer, tourism writer, producer, English teacher, marketing professor, project manager, scriptwriter, communications advisor, communications specialist, social marketing consultant, creative director, director of behavior change lab, and yoga teacher. I actually am a yoga teacher right now. So it's not about finding a single dream that'll make you happy the rest of your life. With all the jobs I've ever had, the best ones had little to do with the actual work and much more to do with the people I work with. It's about being happy. And more importantly, what are you doing with your life shouldn't be just about career. And happiness shouldn't just come from your work. It comes from where you live, comes from the people you surround yourself with and the lifestyle you have. I remember there was a period of my life where I swore I would never do any advertising work. I was wrong. I also had a period of my life where I wanted to be a teacher, which I still want to do eventually, but because of visa laws, I had to leave Thailand. And there was another time when I was even considering being a chef. The secret is you have to realize that a job itself will not make you happy. It's just one part of the puzzle. When someone asks you, what do you want to do with your life? You shouldn't get stressed, you shouldn't get anxious if you don't know what you want to do next. Life is too unpredictable to know your future. The trick is to experience as much as you can so you can learn what you like and what you don't like. The way you do this is by embracing failure with a capital F, really. Failure is awesome. If you fail, it means you're trying something new and you'll actually learn something from it. But if you avoid trying because you're scared or you're worried you won't fit in, then you're not really living. This applies to asking that cute girl or guy that you meet in the library on for a date. It applies when you call that business for the third time to see if you can get an interview, or taking a photography class because it sounded fun. You never know what experience will stick with you, or who you'll end up talking to, but you can't be afraid of trying. If you're brave enough to fail, you'll never regret failing. This goes for work, for love, and for everything that's ever been worthwhile. While you're young, life is incredibly random. Every single decision affects you, and that's what's so beautiful about it. There are 10,000 reasons why my business was able to start in Cambodia, and if even one of them wouldn't have happened, I might not be here today. What if I wouldn't have ran into Rachel in the dorm that day? Or what if Anthony hadn't decided to study abroad? Or what if my business partner or I, what if we decided not to go volunteer together on the day that we met? Truth is, if you can embrace the failures and the randomness of your life while you're young, you enjoy the ride a lot more. Take risks now before you get tied down by debt,
being time you love your parents. You realize later in your life how much they've sacrificed for you, how little you've given to them, and how they can actually be pretty cool. So that's embracing the randomness of your life. And finally, I want to show something to the dreamers out there, to those of you who say that you want to change the world. I have something right here. For those of you who can't see, I'm holding a paperclip. And if I asked you, how many ways can you use this paperclip? You probably list things like hold paper together, or mark pages in books, or make paperclip chains, or something like that. Well, in the late 1960s, two researchers, George Vann and Beth Gemmin, conducted this experiment with 1,600 children, aged 3 to 5, and they asked the same question: how many ways can you use this paperclip? Using the same scoring matrix as they did for NASA, guess how many children scored in a creative genius category? 98%. 10 years later, they conducted the same experiment with the same children, and guess how many scored in the creative genius category then? 10%. They've also conducted this test with more than 200,000 people over 25 years old, and only 2% of them tested in the creative genius category. Why does this happen? Because as we become educated, we learn how to find one answer to one problem that is logical. Hold paper together, mark pages in books. But three to five-year-old children don't have that boundary. They'll imagine the paper clip could be made of rope so that you can lasso a bowl around it. Or they'll say that you can make it really big and do a paper clip dungeon. Unfortunately, we grow in a world where 98% of the world thinks that for every problem there is one solution. And because of this, there's a lot of broken systems. From education to news to politics to healthcare, you will be released in a world that sometimes doesn't make sense and will make you even want to give up. Don't give up. Yes, the world is filled with challenges. Yes, the systems are broken. Yes, you're going to fail. And yes, 98% of the world will tell you you can't do something because things have always been that way. And to them, I'll tell them that when I graduated in 2001, smartphones, Facebook, and YouTube would have been impossible. In 2001, when I graduated, the economic crisis would have been impossible. In 2001, a black president would have been impossible. As you get out in the real world, most people view life like they view the paperclip. To them, life is like a multiple choice test, and if it's not A, B, C, or D, then there are no other possibilities. Don't do that. In this moment, you are filled with an amazing amount of curiosity. Never lose it. The world needs more curious minds. People who believe in seeing the world differently. People who are positive, constantly reinventing themselves, and constantly breaking down barriers. The world needs more people who don't ride down the narrow path, and who choose to explore the unknown territory. The world needs more people who don't see life as full of problems, but full of possibilities. Today, City High Class of 2012, after you get your diplomas, I'm giving you all a paperclip to remind you of how you feel today. Keep it in your wallet and stay curious, stay curious, stay curious. Thank you.
Most to grow if we let them. And we
his high school. Another thing we have in common is that we are here tonight in our caps and gowns, prepared to launch ourselves into the future. I like to think of our lives as lines that we are drawing on a piece of paper. Lines which have intersected at this point in time, which may or may not intersect again in the future. Lines which will spin off in wildly different directions, twisting and curling into shapes abstract but beautiful. Lines which will, in the course of time, weave a remarkable tapestry of life. When I came to City in ninth grade, I was painfully shy, socially awkward, and not very ambitious. But the people here changed me. The teachers and faculty challenged me to do more. I remember well in ninth grade when Ms. Peterson told me that I was going to join legislative debate and that resistance was futile. I also remember when Mr. Van Eyck told us on the first day of AP US History that we were going to be challenged. And I remember the painstaking notes that I had to take for hours, many days, and following months in order to excel. And I remember when this year, Mr. Miller told us that we were going to cover a chapter of macroeconomics for every day or two of class. And I remember when he followed me around the promise, and somehow, managed to teach us the material at the same time. But it wasn't just the faculty that made me a better person. You, class of 2012, did as well. First, most notably, you inspire me. You still do. After all these years, you still inspire me. The sheer quantity of talent in this class never ceases to amaze me. Musicians, mathematicians, writers, speakers, actors, caregivers, and more. But you did more to just inspire me. You took a shy ninth grader, devastated by homeschool syndrome, and made me out of him. You brought me out of my shell by talking to me, even though I was quiet and reclusive. By taking an interest in me, by asking to read the book I wrote, by signing me up for improv club, despite my protest, and showing me a new side of myself. But I'm just one person. This is what I've taken away from City, but all of you have also taken something away from here. And I'm willing to bet that those names will help us in the future. Earlier this year, someone told me that he didn't have much future, didn't have much hope in the future looking at our class. Well, he said that if we were to change his mind, we'd have to come together to do something great. It wasn't an easy year. But somehow, remarkably, despite the fact that we still have our differences, we did come together. Somehow, we assimilated our many differences and created a solidarity which unites us but does not suppress us. I think that is a remarkable achievement. And I think that if our class is anything representative of our generation, there's hope. Direction that you've given us. Thank you, parents and family. Without your faithful support throughout the years, this night would not be possible. And lastly, thank you, class of 2012. It's been quite a ride, and I wish you the best of luck.
Grab some stuff from up here by any chance? Anybody grab some stuff that was up here by any chance?
Did you dump to me?
It's okay. have a speech prepared for you, but it is somewhat vanished up here, and I don't know why. But the gist is this. Over this year, as a first-year principal, I got to know all of you from the very beginning. There it is. All right, bring it on down. I think you did that on purpose. Good evening, Superintendent Neal, President Lanier, board members, executive directors, parents, family members, staff, and the class of 2012. In just a few minutes, the class of 2012 will receive diplomas to mark their graduation from high school. The diplomas these graduates receive represent years of hard work, commitment, dedication, and achievement, and will mark a turning point in the lives of these young people. Certainly, the class of 2012 will greatly be missed, and most of us here tonight can testify to their incredible academic achievements, passionate performances in the arts, and athletic competitions across our great district. If those were the only memories we had of this class, it would be enough to place them as one of the finest groups to ever graduate from City High Middle School. But this group of 96 seniors is so much more than grade point averages, ACT scores, inspiring recitals, and athletic competitions. This class is unique not because of what they have accomplished, but how they accomplished it. They took great care of each other. In an era when it's become easy for young people to focus on individual needs and wants, the class of 2012 stayed together and chose to leave no one behind. I'm extremely proud to say that 100% of this class, 2012, is graduating before us today. The cohesiveness, camaraderie, and caring this class has demonstrated is something for which you will be long remembered. Henry Ford once said, "Coming together is the beginning, keeping together is progress, working together is success." As we look back over the years, certainly there was a beginning, thankfully there was progress, and undeniably you have been successful. As a new principal, the beginning meant getting to know you and building positive relationships with the entire class. It meant setting goals towards graduation and schedules that would not only get you here, but challenge you along the way. We worked together throughout the year to enjoy our one and only year as principal and cohort by leading events such as Homecoming Week, Earth Day, the Econometology Expo, and who could forget your Emmy Award-winning city staff impersonation skit during our field day assembly. You guys did a remarkable job. The end result of our coming together, keeping together, and working together in spite of obstacles that we may have faced along the way, that end result is the graduating class of 2012. But until now, your education has been meticulously planned for you, usually in discrete packets and units. You generally knew what was going to be taught and how you would be assessed so that you could prove you had learned something. The funny thing about real life is that there are no longer learning objectives written on a board to guide you. Learning becomes much more difficult to quantify, and most real life tests are unannounced, especially tests involving your character, ethics, the environment, and empathy for others. By the way, these tests may well continue for the rest of your lives. Let me offer a piece of advice. As you pursue your dreams over the next decade, watch how incredibly smart your parents get. It turns out that parents are pretty skilled at picking up on real life lessons. Continue to talk and listen to them as they have learned from their mistakes and will save you much stress, anxiety, and money. They also will not charge you for their expertise, and most of the time, you may even get a free meal out of the deal. Class of 2012, here's a final thought I'd like to share with you. Set your goals high and strive to develop your skills and potential, but be careful in how you measure your success. If you choose to be the best in the world, remember that that title is fleeting and usually placed on you temporarily by others. Your success will be judged by those whom with you compete. Being the best in the world does not necessarily guarantee that you will develop all your skills. It might simply mean you have outshone others in a rather limited area and time frame. By being the best for the world, you will constantly be challenged to develop your talents as well as those around you, and only you will be able to judge the success of your life. Seniors, we wish you everything that you so richly deserve in the years ahead, It has been an honor and a privilege watching you progress and watching your success. Congratulations.
Shown by Justice and Marshall when they helped the class
I was there to say a few words about my time at City. And here they are. City High emits one of the best environments that I've ever been in. And I travel quite a lot around Michigan in fact. This place kind of helped me find lifelong friends, and in a sense, helped me find myself. So, excuse me if I mumble a little bit or stumble as I'm talking. It's because right here at this podium, I've realized that I'm leaving a place that helped make me. As I look out into the audience tonight, I see proud parents, family, cousins. I see teachers and faculty. See my students, not my students, my fellow students. We've struggled together, we've succeeded together, we've done among other things that I will not mention tonight. The board. But as I stand here tonight, I just want to thank everyone for being there, for everyone. I'm not going to stand here and tell my class to become millionaires. But if you do, don't mind sending me some cash. My father, who's not here right now, told me, in life, it's not about the things or the money that you receive. It's about finding yourself. Once you find yourself, the rest will come easier anyway. It took me a while, but I pondered what he said to me. And a couple years later, 4 years later, last week, I figured out what he was trying to say. It was that he said that, I'm pretty sure he meant, find yourself and you'll find other people like you. Find the community and help make the community in which you want to live in. I have other family here who I may not be related to, that have given me plenty of wisdom that I will carry on for the rest of my life. One of my grandparents, our grandfather, always told me, faith, family, and friends. Faith. Believe in something. Take up a cause. Family. That is the home where love begins. And friends, well, they're friends and they will help you and get you in a lot of trouble. Thank you, Matt DuPont, for busting me out. Not out of jail, by the way. I'll leave with one final, well, with a couple words from one of my favorite art authors. It's from a poem. It goes, it matters not how straight the gate, how charged the punishments the scroll. I am the master of my fate, and I am the captain of my soul. So, class of 2012, I love you. Stay frosty. And we did it.
struggling.
By the way, I never got an Emmy, and I don't think anybody else did who helped out with that skit, but...
Mr. Pascal, thank you for making me an offer that I cannot refuse. You're the godfather. Thanks for being here. How's it going, my guy?
All right, here we go. Father's here, hear the yell, back to school, show a bell, brand new shoes, walk in the news, climb the fence, books and pens, I can tell that we are gonna be friends. I can tell that we are gonna be friends. Walk with me, Susie Lee, through the park and by the tree, we will rest on the ground and look at all the bugs we found. Safely walk to school without a sound. Safely walk to school without a sound. Here we are, no one else. We walk to school all by ourselves. There's dirt on our uniforms, chasing all the ants and worms. We clean up and now it's time to learn. We clean up and now it's time to learn. Numbers, letters, learn to spell. Nouns and books and show and tell. Playtime, we throw the ball. Back to class, through the hall. Teacher marks our height against the wall. T-shirt marks are high against the wall. We don't notice any time pass. We don't notice anything. Say side, side, side in every class. Teacher thinks that I sound funny, but she likes the way you sing. Tonight I'll dream while I'm in bed. Silly thoughts go through my head about the notes and alphabet. When tomorrow I'll bet that we can, I will.
Zachary James Abed. Sergio Ivan Butron Flores. Jeremiah Noel Bukowski. Whitney Linnell Burney. Brittany May Burstra. Mallory Clemence Kyle Jones. Mackenzie Elizabeth Campbell. Suzanne Carson. Stephen James Collison II. Megan Elizabeth Crawford. Thank you. Matthew Blake DuPont. Annalisa and Meg. Jonathan Zachary French. Shannon Lee Fryover. Milo C. Gearing. Ethan Russell Glass. Pierre Lasergio Gober. Maria Guadalupe Gonzalez. Jacob Benjamin Green. Emily Juliana Guy. Gabriella Guzman. Dylan Russell Hall. Sarah Ann Harrington. Kaylee Jo Heine. Madeline Margaret Hoffman. May Schaefer Hogan. DeAndrea. Haley Sia Jacoby. Jan Jorgens.
Jack Patrick O'Brien.
Mitchell Ross Spalding. Duncan James White.
I hereby confer diplomas on each of you. Congratulations.